In this video, I am listing the top 5 things you do not need to be doing if you're training your dog through activity. So if you're interested in learning what not to do, keep watching. What's up, guys? It's Denim with Dog Liaison, where I coach you on how to enhance your dog's mental health. I'm a professional dog trainer, and in my signature program, the Recovering Rover program, we coach our clients through how to resolve their dog's reactivity, aggression, and other anxiety disorders. In today's video, we are talking about the top 5 things you do not want to be doing in order to train your reactive dog. However, I do want to let you know that in my very next video, I'm going to be giving you the most comprehensive tutorial on how to train your reactive or aggressive dog. So if you don't want to miss that, make sure you hit the notification bell so that you get notified when that video is released. If you're watching this video well into the future, I have linked it at the end of this video and it's in the description box. Let's get into the content. The number one thing you absolutely do not want to be doing in your dog's training for reactivity is taking your dog towards the stimulus simply so that he can get used to it. Now, here's the thing. This mentality of taking your dog and exposing him to the trigger, that's based in something called desensitization, which is indeed a good thing, okay? There's nothing wrong with quote-unquote exposure therapy. However, the key here is that in order for desensitization to be effective, it needs to be at such a minor exposure of stress that the dog is not being what we call flooded. So flooding is when the dog is so overwhelmed with the trigger and is so in the heat of the trigger that he's not even able to process what's actually going on. He just goes over threshold, he's in his fight, flight, or freeze response, and really limited to no learning is occurring. So if we are using desensitization correctly, what we actually want to do is to make sure that we are at such a minor exposure to the stimulus that our dog is actually able to process what's going on. Now again, in my next video, I'm going to break down exactly how we do this, but the moral of this lesson is that I want you to not be flooding your dog. I don't want you just thinking that if I take Rover to the dog park, he's suddenly going to be okay with other dogs. It doesn't really work that way. There's a methodical process to desensitization. It's not just arbitrary exposure. And this leads me into the next thing that you do not want to be doing with your reactive dog, and that is training after he goes over threshold or after he demonstrates that excessive behavior response. So he's already lunging, he's already barking, he's already pulling, he's already doing the undesired behavior, and then you swoop in to give that correction. That's already happening too late, my friend. Your behavior is now retroactive, and what we want to do is we want to be proactive. We want to prevent the lunge, prevent the pull, prevent the behavior from occurring in the first place. I think a lot of times we think of corrections as sort of the dog does the undesired thing and then we tell them that that was undesired. What we actually want to be doing is setting our dog up for success from the get-go so that they know what to do instead. We want to be setting up the environment, setting up the criteria, and setting up the learning opportunity for our dog to be successful from the onset so that we're not getting that lunging at all. And so you might be thinking right now, okay, Jenna, if we're going to be preventing the behavior, what behavior should we be having our dog do instead? Well, typically I recommend the engage, disengage game, which you can learn about in this tutorial right here, or you can give your dog some sort of pattern-oriented game, which you can learn about in this video. But the idea is that we want to be giving our dog an alternative action that is a healthy response. And what that action is going to be dependent on what the environment and what the context is calling for. One of the things that I try to teach all of my clients is that there is no one go-to behavior for all cases that your dog is ever going to face. What behavior or what action you have your dog do could range anywhere from just smelling the ground to actually doing an obedience skill like a sit or a down. It just depends on what the context is calling for, and so our job is to equip your dog with as many skills, as a wide skill repertoire as we possibly can that he enjoys, so that we can always prevent that reactivity, prevent that undesired behavior from occurring. Now, often when I tell our clients that, hey, I want you guys to teach your dog this skill, whether that's a pattern or I want you to teach your dog to roll over, I want your dog to learn how to sit, stay, whatever it is, a lot of times my clients get all wrapped up in their head and start overanalyzing their technique. And this leads me into the third thing you do not want to be doing if you are training your dog through activity, and that is overanalyzing your training technique. My friend, start messy. What we are not going for is perfectionist. We are not trying to be the world's cleanest, most precise dog trainer in the universe. The truth of the matter is that even professional dog trainers are going to be a little bit more slack and are going to, you know, quote unquote, make mistakes when it comes to technique. And here's what I have to say. If your training method, if whatever method you're using to train your dog is so reliant on you having your shoulders down and you having your hand in a specific position and you having the most clear tone, if it is so reliant on those things that if you don't do it, it all falls apart, then the training technique probably isn't a very good one. Because if you're using a proper counter conditioning and desensitization protocol that is based in science, if you're using those protocols correctly, there is room for error. You can afford to start messy and still get progress. And that's not to say you don't need to eventually worry about your technique. That's not to say that you can always afford to have your treat or your hand in your treat pouch. That's not to say that you always can be staring down at your dog forever. Eventually, yeah, you're gonna need to be aware of where are your hands. You're gonna need to be aware of where are you looking. But those things can come later. And one of the things that I tell our clients in the RRP is that you want to think of those things, those minute details that you have to focus on, you want to think of that as a privilege. It's almost as if you have done so much progress already that you have the privilege of worrying about something as minute as, am I using my peripherals instead of staring down at my dog? Those things can come later. And so I encourage you to just start. Start the training process now. Don't worry about starting messy. It's gonna be okay. The fourth mistake that I see dog parents do when they are training their dog to their activity is that they prioritize loose leash walking, or they prioritize giving their dog the perfect, flawless sit stay. And the truth of the matter is that those are things that can come later as well. I'm not saying you're never gonna have to teach your dog to walk nicely by your side. That's probably going to be important. However, is it the most important part? Is it even the first three most important parts? Absolutely not. If your trainer is prioritizing obedience skills or loose leash walking, which I would consider part of obedience, if your trainer is prioritizing that, then they probably don't have good understanding of what reactivity is. And if you're looking for an understanding of what actually reactivity or aggression is, you can watch this video where I really break down the denotation and the connotation of what reactivity is. But if your trainer is prioritizing obedience, then they don't really have an understanding of the fight, flight, or freeze response or how the amygdala is affecting the body. And this is really comes down to more of a physiological thing that if you're looking for a deeper dive, make sure you hit that like button to let me know, and maybe we'll get a science on the neurology of reactivity. But when we're talking about reactivity, what's really coming into play is that the amygdala is sending out the message to the rest of the body that, oh my gosh, some emergency is happening. We better pump ourselves up with adrenaline. We better pump ourselves up with blood and oxygen so that we can prepare for this major event. In order to resolve that, in order to keep the dog below threshold so that he is in a learning part of his brain, obedience is not required. What's instead required is systematic counter conditioning and desensitization. So if you are prioritizing loose leash walking and getting the perfect flawless sit stay, I'm not saying that's unimportant. I'm not saying never focus on that. I'm saying it's something you don't have to worry about for a very, very, very long time. Let's get the basics set, and then you can cross that bridge when you get there. The fifth mistake that I see dog parents do when they're resolving their dog's reactivity or aggression for that matter is that they overtrain or undertrain. So that is to say that they are training too frequently or they're not training frequently enough at all. Now, here's what I mean. For starters, I have the opinion that every single dog has their own set preference for how often they're going to work through reactivity or any sort of anxiety-related behavior at all. Some dogs are going to do a lot better if they are training more frequently. Some dogs are going to prefer to do it, you know, once a week, if that. So I am of the belief that that's something that we need to experiment with to ask your dog, you know, is this too frequent? Is this too little? I am of the belief that only your dog can answer that. However, with that said, there is a general basis for you to start with. You're not necessarily flying blind. So for example, if you tell me that your dog gets reactive every single time you have guests come over, and then I ask you, okay, how often do you have guests over? And you say once every 3 months, and that's how often you're training, I'm gonna be like, okay, that's far too little. No, we don't have enough practice for the main event. We don't have enough rehearsal time for when you actually need to have guests come over. So that's happening far too little. Now, if you tell me that, well, we have guests come over once a week and we're training every single time we have a guest come over that once a week, I'm gonna say, okay, that seems a little bit more fair, right? I don't necessarily anticipate that you will have guests coming over 5 times per week. That's not realistic. On the other hand, if you tell me that your dog is reactive on walks, and then I ask you, how often are you training your dog on walks? And you tell me every single day like clockwork at 7 a.m., I'm probably going to suggest that that might be too frequent. I'm probably going to suggest if you're not seeing the progress that you want, or if it's feeling overwhelming, not just for your dog, but it's feeling like a lot of work for you, then you probably want to cut down your training sessions to maybe only 3-4 times a week, if that. So as a rule of thumb, you want to think about how much time does your dog have to recover. And actually, one of the things that I'm going to be doing in 2 weeks is I'm going to be releasing a video on how often to train your reactive dog. So in the future, when that comes out, I will make sure that's linked in the description box, because I do think that that will be a good expansion on this conversation. Make sure you hit the notification bell so you get notified when that drops. Now, as I said in my very next video, I am giving you the step-by-step process. It is my most detailed tutorial to date on how to resolve your dog's aggression, reactivity, or any other emotional response behavior like that. So if you're looking for that big comprehensive tutorial, make sure you hit the notification bell so you get notified when I drop that video. If you are watching this well into the future, then I have linked it right here and you can check that out now. Have a wonderful day and we'll chat soon.